السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه وبعد. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless his entire household, beginning with his wives and his offspring and all those family members of his. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them and bless all his companions and those who have struggled and strived to protect the deen and to transmit it to us through the chain. And may Allah make us from those who consider this a gift and from those who realize how fortunate they are to be from amongst the purest of the pure followers of the deen, or followers of the purest of the pure deen. And we ask Allah to bless us and our offspring and to keep us all steadfast on this deen at all times. Ameen. My beloved brothers and sisters, firstly, I would like to say I am humbled by such large attendance. Not only that, but I wish that the men could go outside and let the females come inside. It's one thing. We are normally accused of inequality and you know, prejudiced against women. And I think if someone had to witness this evening, they might start with that misconception, because it is a big misconception. It is just that we had to make a plan. We had to hatch a plan and we had no option. So we thought of the best option, and I was quite happy to hear that there were some fans and some screens as well as some speakers, which means it seems like the people here are jacked up according to our language, mashallah. So mashallah, we apologize to the sisters, and at the same time remember, every one of us seated here, we are not here for the individual. We are here for the sake of Allah. And we are here because we want to learn something. No matter who you are here because you want to learn something. I am here because I love you for the sake of Allah. And I want to share with you a few things. Perhaps I may benefit from it. I may be reminded myself from what I'm about to say. And you may be taking one word away at least. If one word has moved you by 0.5%, inshallah, we have achieved a lot. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us humility and humbleness, and may He accept the sacrifice of the sisters out there in the humidity who are not tasting the exact air conditioning that we have here. But believe me, in Jannah, you will have much better than this. This evening we are speaking of misconceptions regarding Islam, and we want to say how people have created a lot of these misconceptions, because Islam has no misconception within it as such. It is people who create these misconceptions and peddle them, and this is why we have to have forums of this nature where we can answer questions and we can speak about what people are saying. Firstly, we have the most beautiful religion. You need to know. Number one, misconception. People say Islam is a new religion. It came and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought it. It was unheard of before, and there were no Muslims, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the first Muslim. That is incorrect. We believe that from the time Allah created Adam, may peace be upon him, a Muslim is a submitter unto Allah. Al-Muslim, he is the one who is mustaslim lillah. A Muslim is the one who submits to the command of his maker. So if I want to know if I'm a Muslim, I need to ask myself, do I submit? And Islam very beautifully also has the meaning of peace in it. And one of the ideas, or one of the reasons, is whoever submits attains peace. Have you seen that? Whoever submits attains peace. So it is an ingredient towards inner peace and outer peace. You submit to what your maker has decided, you attain peace. Let me quickly give you the example of a motor vehicle. I was in Cape Town a few days ago, and I have to share this with you. And a brother of mine says, you know what, I'd like you to test drive my new vehicle. I thought, okay, you know, perhaps. I told him, brother, you know what, you need to know one thing. Don't think for a moment that there is barakah in my hand, so if I touch the steering, your car will last longer. Don't think that for a moment. What you need to know is that, yes, as a friend, perhaps let me test this vehicle. MashaAllah. And the brother was excited, and when I saw the vehicle, I also became excited. MashaAllah. What was it? A car I'd only seen on the screens. It was a brand new Lamborghini. SubhanAllah. See everyone saying, whoa, MashaAllah. So he tells me, have you ever driven a Steptronic vehicle? And I said, yes, I have. Because just a week before that, one of my friends had purchased a Toyota Corolla. And I normally drive that vehicle when I arrive in Johannesburg, and it had gears just behind the steering. And you have to, there is no park on it, it just says E, and you drive behind, meaning you change your gears behind the steering wheel. So he told me, look, you press this button, you do this, and I was listening. Listen, this is a point I'm about to raise. I'm about to take something out of this. So listen to the story. He tells me, you know, you do this, there is a plus sign and a minus sign, you lower the gear here, you know, you raise it there, and then he tells me, if you want to hear the sound, now you know there is a sound of these vehicles, then when you are driving at gear 4, you just suddenly put it in 3, and he says you will hear them. You know what I'm saying? You suddenly hear the sound, you know, and that is what makes a Lamborghini, the sound. Subhanallah. So what happened is, I obeyed instructions. Why? Because the man knows more than me what to do with the vehicle, and he knows, he has probably read the manual before me, and he, it's his vehicle, so he has to tell me, and I am a fool if I don't listen to him. I am a fool. If I press the accelerator instead of the brake, what happens? I am foolish. So man becomes so foolish, the one who made the Lamborghini, we are ready to follow his instruction, but the one who made man, who is much more sophisticated, we are not ready to follow his instruction. Look at how man is. And we think for a moment that he did not send us a manual. He knows there is a brake. I need to apply brakes at a certain point in my life. I cannot carry on the way I am carrying on, turning away from my own maker. There must be a brake. If I move at 200 miles an hour, I will bump into the world and it will create a huge fireball in which I will die. So the same applies spiritually. I can die in a huge fireball if I continue rushing towards this dunya without taking heed of the message of the messengers, and I am moving at 200 miles an hour, I bump into everything wrong. Allahu Akbar. So let us apply our brakes. We apply our brakes and we realize that the misconception that Islam has only started now is something we will automatically know. It is wrong because the maker who made will not make without an instruction. From the beginning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks in the Quran, as well as in the Old Testament, as well as in the other books that He has revealed to mankind about how He created man and about the warnings He issued from the time of Adam alayhi salatu wa salam.
قَالَ يَا آدَمُ إِنَّ هَذَا عَدُوٌ لَكَ وَلِزَوْجِكَ.
From before Adam alayhi salam had committed a sin, he was already warned to say, do you know what? This is your enemy. He has not prostrated to you. He has not acknowledged you in the first place out of jealousy, saying, أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْهُ. I am better than you. So, he is your enemy. Be careful. He has already taken a promise or made a promise to lead you astray. Watch out. Watch out. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us all from the beginning. Thereafter, when Adam alayhi salatu wasalam came down and he arrived on the earth, what happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned him again, and Allah sent him messages again, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed him to warn his own children, and this is why he told his children and he warned them and so on. So from the very beginning, the people who were submitted to Allah at the time of Adam were known as Muslim, which means submitters. The people who did not submit were not known as Muslim because they did not submit. And this is why as we go down the ladder, we will find the Prophet Nuh. The Prophet Noah, may peace be upon him, he came with the message. He told the people what to do. Those who accepted his message were surrenderers. They surrendered and they accepted the law of the Almighty, and therefore they were known as Muslim. And yes, later on, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah told him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him that before you, we have sent messengers, many messengers.
وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ رُسُلًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِمْ.
So many messengers we sent to their people. And there are so many verses of this nature. Full, the Quran is full of verses. In one place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
مِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَصَصْنَا عَلَيْكَ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ لَمْ نَقْصُصْ عَلَيْكَ.
Some of those messengers, we have related to you their stories. And some of them, we have not related to you. So what is in common between Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the others? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that he has sent the messengers, all of them had one message. What was the message?
أَنِعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ.
Worship Allah alone and be careful of طاغوت. طاغوت has a very broad meaning. Anything wrong, Anything to do with the devil and shaitan, anything in the wrong direction is known as taghut. And therefore we should be careful of taghut. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we sent all messengers with one message, to worship Allah alone. So the issue of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all the messengers came with it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that with the stories of every prophet he sent, he says that each one of them was instructed, first things first, worship Allah alone. أَنِعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مَا لَكُم مِّنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرُهُ. Worship Allah, there is no God and deity for you besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And who is Allah? We always say the maker, the creator, the nourisher, the cherisher, the sustainer, the provider, the protector. All these are the qualities of the Almighty who made me and whom I'm going to return to. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is very sad when people say Islam is a new religion. No, the tenets of belief are the same. Perhaps the Sharia can change from time to time. What does that mean? What is permissible, what is prohibited in terms of actions and doings and foods and so on, that can change from time to time, and the rules can actually, you know, change, differ. For example, we drive in vehicles, we have glass homes, mashallah, we have air conditioning and so on. This is all made permissible for us in our Sharia. And in another Sharia, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had prohibited certain things. In fact, at the time of the Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, a certain group of people were told, if you would like forgiveness, then you need to kill yourself. Allahu Akbar. The Quran says that there was a certain group of people, as a test for them, they were told, if you want to be forgiven, you need to kill yourself. Now, that may not be understood by us right now. We only know that they followed a certain rule and regulation. It does not apply to us today. So the Sharia changes, but the belief does not change. What are the pillars of belief? Amantu billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rusulihi wal yawmil akhir wal qadar. خيره وشره من الله والبعث. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about all these pillars of iman. When we say iman, أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته, it's in the hadith of Jibreel, a common hadith which is known. I'm sure it should be known by all of us, and if it is not, we need to go and search it, and we need to make sure we know what is the meaning of hadith Jibreel. It's a powerful hadith. When a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was so handsome, he was wearing white, so white, and he had black hair, and no one knew him, and he did not look like he came from a journey. Subhanallah. This is the hadith of Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. Nobody knew him, but it did not look like he came from a journey. And this means that he was definitely a foreigner, but there was something strange about him. That is, no one knew him, and yet he was not looking tired. What happened to his journey? Today, when a person comes to you from very far away, you find him, you know, he's tired and he's looking at you and he's yawning whilst he's talking. This man came, asnada rukbatayhi ila rukbatayhi. He sat right in front of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to the degree that his knees were touching the knees of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he asks him questions. What is Islam? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam answered with the pillars of Islam. Then he says, that is correct. So the Sahaba was surprised, radiallahu anhum. How can a man come and ask me, how old are you? And then you say, I am 35. And they say, that is correct. So why did you ask me? So this was something else. He asked, what is Islam? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him that Islam is these. And he mentioned the five pillars. And now you have, sorry, just take a look at the notices there, inshallah. Now you have a difficulty. The man is asking and he is correcting. Then he says, what is Iman? So the pillars of Iman were mentioned. So he says, Sadaqt, which means, you know, you asked, yes, yes, that's correct. Again, Ajibna lahu. Yes, Al? You know, we are surprised that this man, he's asking, and at the same time, he is saying you are correct. And it continued, the hadith continued. The point that I am raising here is that you look at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who answered the question of Iman. That Iman is the same from the beginning to the end. All the messengers taught about belief in the angels, belief in the heavenly books before them, belief in good and bad fate coming from Allah, the fact that He's in control, belief in a resurrection. All the messengers came with belief, all of them. Belief in the fact that there is none worthy of worship besides your maker, and that the person who is holding the message of the time is indeed the messenger. May Allah's peace be upon all of them. So this is what we say, that Islam is not new. Jesus, may peace be upon him, came. He warned people about resurrection. He warned them about a day to come when they will answer to their maker. He told them, worship the maker alone. Do not worship me. He told them that. When they changed it later on, that was their error. That was a manifest plot. Whatever had happened, it's our right to believe what we want to believe. To believe whatever we consider to be correct. And believe me, even if you speak to the Christians, they doubt the issue of Trinity. They doubt it. Even at the highest level. I went to a Christian high school, secondary school, and some of my friends have gone very far and become clergy in their own, you know, right. And we talk to them, they cannot talk to us. They cannot compete. They cannot compete with Islam. My brother, I worship the one who made me. I say, oh my maker, I worship you. I put my head on the ground only for the one who made me, no one else. I put my head on the ground for he whom I'm going to return to alone, no one else. And I call him the worshipped one, Allah, Rabbun. Rabb means who made, nourishes, cherishes, sustains, provides, who is in absolute control of every aspect of my existence. So my head goes on the ground only for him. They just look at you because they don't have an answer. They don't have an answer. Because if you are to say, and I mentioned this earlier today, if you are to say, oh Jesus, help me. Let's put Islam for a moment at one's place and let us look at it from a secular point of view, which means just talk to them from your brain, from a brain point of view. If someone says, oh Jesus, help me, Jesus can either help you or not help you. That is the probability according to the brain. That if I ask someone, please help me, they can either help you or not help you. When I ask someone, please save me, please forgive me, please grant me happiness, please grant me paradise, they can either grant you or not. I'd rather stay away from the probability of it being granted or not by a person. Go out of that whole doubt, go out of the whole probability issue, may or may not, and just ask direct, oh owner of paradise, grant me paradise. Oh you whom I'm going to return to, forgive me when I get to you, or have mercy on me when I get to you, and so on. Or have mercy on me now, oh you who is in absolute control of my entire existence, have mercy on me, forgive me. This is where the word Rabbun comes from. Rabb. What is a Rabb? I just explained it moments ago. The one who creates, nourishes, cherishes, provides, sustains, and so on. It's interesting to know it off by heart. Because when we say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, a lazy way of translating it is, praise be to Allah, Lord of the world. That's a lazy way of translating it. But sometimes we have to do that for time purposes. Allah protect us. We need to know as Muslims. So, misconception number one, we've got it out of the scene, because we now know that Islam, as it is, was taught from the beginning. And that Iman that is there, the belief from the very beginning, came down all the way up to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it was taught and given to those who had not had a messenger before. Those, the Arabs of Mecca and the people of Quraysh that this was initially started with, they at some point accepted it. Initially they were very, you know, hostile towards the message. Anyone comes to you with a pure message, sometimes people feel hostile because shaitan is there and he makes you say, this man is saying قال الله وقال الرسول. No. These two things alone cannot be Islam. Islam, you need to add things. I said yesterday, in Malaysia, we like to add spice, mashallah, to our food. I tasted some of it last night, mashallah. Some of it was edible and some of it was very tasty, but you know, they say, mashallah, a little bit too spicy sometimes for the tongue. Let's stop there, inshallah. So, we don't want to add spice in our religion as well. We don't want to add spice. Go back to the pure Islam. What is wrong with it? Nothing. But remember something. Don't develop an air about yourself just because Allah has accepted you, you know, to understand that what I'm doing is wrong and I need to get back to what is right. And what should make you happy is when you obey Allah's instruction, knowing the instruction. When you obey the messenger's instruction, knowing the instruction. This is the instruction. I read this and I know this. It's the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, undisputed. How can I challenge that? And this is why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, I have left with you two things. For as long as you hold fast unto them, you will not go astray. One is the Kitab and one is my Sunnah. The Quran and the Hadith. Today there are people fighting the Hadith. They tell you this is the Quran. And that's it. We accept only the Quran. Anything out of the Quran, we don't want it. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that type of behavior. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about those people. And he says there will come a time when a man will be sitting back on his sofa, reclining back, saying, oh, this is the Quran, and I take whatever, what halal is in it, I consider halal, what haram is in it, I consider haram, nothing else. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, ala inni utitul Qur'ana wa mithlahu ma'ahu. I want you to be warned, ala tanbih, I want you to be warned, behold, lo, hey, you should know that I have been given the Quran and something similar to it together with it, and that is the Sunnah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us steadfastness. We also need to realize that right at the beginning, a woman, a female, was created according to the hadith of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, and according to the Mufassirin, and according to the verse of the Quran at the beginning of the surah, which is named after the women. A woman was created from a man. So a man was initially created from the dust. The dust was then, water was added to it, it became soil and clay and so on. And then a shape was given to it, and thereafter a life was given to it, and it became man. Actually, who I am, I spoke 2 weeks ago in my city in Harare, and I started off by saying, my beloved brothers and sisters, I am just a lump of clay. And they were just looking at me. But it's true. My body is made from soil, from clay. And someone might say, well, there's a contradiction in the Quran. This is also a misconception. Why sometimes the Quran says man is created from a clot of blood? Why sometimes man is created from this liquid semen? Why sometimes man is created from dust? Why sometimes man is created from clay? Why sometimes man is created from the dried clay? Why all these different words? Well, very simple answer to that. Very simple. These are the different stages in the creation of man. Initially, dust was taken, water was added. So that means man was created from dust initially. And that was the first man. And water was taken, mixed soil and clay and so on, given shape, dried up, kalfakhar, and it carries on. Then Allah gave it life. And thereafter, man was then created through semen that was produced by that man who was created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And after that, when the fusion of the gametes occurs, you have a ball, and the zygote, you can call it, or embryo, whatever you'd like to call it, at one stage it is a clot of blood. So there's nothing wrong. And Allah mentions these stages. Don't let someone come and con your brain to say there is a contradiction in the Quran. One place it says this, the other place it says that. There is no contradiction. It is speaking of the different times within the creation of man. So for me and you today, yes, it is a drop of semen and it is a clot of blood. But for the time of Adam alayhi salam, it's different. Now the time of Eve, Hawa alayha salatu wasalam, it is reported in the hadith of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu that Hawa alayha salatu wasalam, or Eve, may peace be upon her, was created from the rib of Adam. Was created from the rib of Adam. This hadith is found in many books. So I came across some people who said that is an insult to women. Abu Huraira doesn't know what he is talking about. Astaghfirullah. Why do you want to insult Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu because you don't understand something that Allah has done? Forget about what you were created from. Just know who you are right now. Allahu Akbar. If you want to debate, let's not debate, because a man might argue that Allah insulted me. How can He make me from dust? Today when there is dust on my shoes, I like to move it and polish it. How can I be created from the same dust? Have you thought of it? If man wanted to look at guilt, and if man wanted to look at what he considers not being honored, he would be able to justify that more than a woman. Because a woman is created from a bone, something alive, a bone with flesh on it, a rib, mashallah. Sometimes you eat these chops, have you ever eaten them? Mashallah. They are the tastiest part of the animal, subhanallah. So Allah chose, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about mirmatayni hasanatayn in one hadith. He speaks about the tastiest part that he used to like of the animal that was on a spit and so on. And he speaks of the meat between these two ribs. Amazing. How sweet it is and so on. So, my dear female, understand, you are sweeter than a man. MashaAllah. And on top of that, there is no insult. You are created from something alive. Something alive. Now, that doesn't mean that you talk more than men. But what it does mean, I hope you took that lightly, inshallah. What it does mean is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses. I have absolutely no say in the choice that Allah has made to make me from dust. And one of the beauties, this what I'm about to tell you is not from Quran or Sunnah, just the statement I'm about to say now, but it's the beauty of man is because we are made from the earth, everything we like is also from the earth. Nothing outside the earth actually benefits us at this moment. So you look at your glasses, look at your hat, look at your clothing. The cotton is from the farm, mashallah. The leather is from the cow or whatever else. And you know, you have the tin is from the mine and so on. All this is from the earth. It's not from outside. And I have said this so many times. Our brains are such that we cannot think about anything from Venus, let alone paradise. I said this yesterday. So that is man. We created from the earth because we were meant to live here for a period of time. So if anyone says it is an insult for a woman to be created from a rib, we will say no, it isn't. And if someone says Islam is wrong, we now have to tell them something else. We have to say, look, from an Islamic point of view, there are a hadith, there are narrations, there is everything, but even the other religions believe the same. Now what are you going to say? Even the other religions believe the same. Now what are you going to say? There is another misconception. That misconception is coming from the Christians. They say that Eve was the one who led Adam to that apple. Islam does not really agree with that. Allah says, both of them were guilty of the crime. You don't blame one for the other. I know there was a long time ago when I had read some book, and you know, you read books. Initially, we read many books, and sometimes we are impressed by what is said. So we read, yes, Hawa was the one who caused Adam alayhi salatu wasalam to fall because she said, oh, my husband, come. I want to show you something. And the man, you know, the way they word it, the love of his wife. And he started, you know, running in one side and he said, okay, let's have a taste. Don't make it sound like it's a cartoon. No. Later on, I found that knowledge, sometimes you need to admit your fault and you need to know that I now have purer knowledge than before, subhanallah. Why? Because it is more authenticated. And this is why we should always be looking for that which is authenticated in Islam. If someone says, look brother, this is authenticated, have a peep at it. Take some time to look at it. Sometimes people say, no, I am an accountant and I am busy. I don't have time to go and see what is authentic and what is not authentic. How can we say that when this life of ours is more important that we have a link with our maker than to have a link with our accountancy? But we understand it the other way around. If the accountant came to you and said, brother, the law has changed tonight, from tomorrow morning they are going, the tax man is going to come to all your clients, X, Y, and Z will happen, we won't sleep that night. I want to read and authenticate the law. Why? My men, my clients, my business, and so on. What about my Allah, my Jannah, my, you know, Akhirah? What about that? We need to spend a little bit of time authenticating. We want to be better Muslimin. Without learning about Islam, we don't really stand a big chance. You have to make an effort. Tonight you are here. Allah reward you. It is not easy to come out. It is not easy to make time. It is not easy to sit. Amongst us there are dignitaries. Amongst us there are VIPs. Amongst us there are senior figures. Today we are seating all equal, mashallah. May Allah grant us that humility. And we have come here as Muslimin to learn. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really open your doors. Let's never ever fall for misconceptions without going and finding out. You know what the Quran says? The Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it very clearly. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَالزُّبُرِ. Ask those who have the knowledge, أَهْلُ الذِّكْرِ, those who know the revelation. Ask those who have sound knowledge, if you do not know the evidences from the revelation, they will show you the evidences from the revelation. So ask, don't be shy. Someone says, you know what, the Quran has a contradiction. The Quran says in one place that Allah created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, and in another place it says 2 days, and in another place it says 4 days. To be honest with you, go and read it again and read it properly. There is no contradiction. Because Allah speaks of creating the heavens and the earth and whatever is between it in 6 days, in one place, correct. And in another place, He speaks only of the earth. And then He makes mention of 2 days. Then He makes mention of four for the rest. 4 plus 2 is 6. You get back to the same. So people say, no, that's a contradiction. And they show the Muslims. I have had someone come to me, and mashallah, they were laughing after I showed them that, do you know addition? Bring your calculator. It's 4 plus 2, but you won't know it. You know? Why do we want to quickly jump to the conclusion? Subhanallah. Just read it again, see it properly, go to someone who has knowledge. Mashallah, you have ulama in your midst, and tell them, look, I just want to know, what is this? How come here it says 4, here it says 2, and so on? No contradiction. That is just a misconception. So this misconception about women being, you know, some, what can I say, unidentified flying object coming from space, that's not true. We honor a woman. A woman was given as a gift to man. To be honest with you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed Adam alayhi salam by giving him company, by giving him a woman, by giving him, and this is why Allah says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Allah says, one of the signs of Allah is that He has created for you, from you, your spouse, so that you can achieve comfort and solace from the spouse. And He has kept between you love and mercy. And these are the signs for those who are going to ponder. May Allah make us from those who ponder. What a beautiful verse of the Quran. There is a misconception in Islam, one of the biggest misconceptions of today's time. They say, in Islam, a woman is oppressed. Now, some of you who've heard my previous lectures might know how we tackle this sometimes. Everyone has a different way of tackling it, and in a nutshell, a woman is not oppressed. They say, you know, where is equality in Islam? Where is equality in Islam? I read the Arab News last week. Arab News is a newspaper from Saudi Arabia, and they say there was a non-Muslim woman from one of the Western countries who visited one of the ministries there, and she needed the loo. And she was very, very outraged that there was only male loos and no female loos. So one person happened to say, and this is something we need to think about, you people are the ones who promote equality. There is one loo for all of us. Allahu Akbar. One loo for all of us. The same people who are saying, I am equal to a man, they don't want to use the same loo as a man. Because they are confirming that, no, I am different from a man. I need a separate loo. They are saying, I am physically different, but I am equal to you. So, why do we say Mr. So-and-so? Let me use some, you know, names. Why do we say Mr. John and Mrs. Mary? Why don't we say Mr. Mary and Mr. John? Why does that extra S come in? Why? Because you are confirming they are different. There is difference. In Islam, we believe a woman is equal to a man. Equal. We are equals where Allah has made us equal. And she is higher than us where Allah has given her that height. A woman can give birth, which is an act of worship a man cannot engage in. Have you ever thought of that? A woman breastfeeds her child, which is an act of worship a man can only, in fact, he wouldn't even want to dream of, because of the difficulty of it, it's not so easy. It requires the gentle touch of a female. A female goes through a monthly cycle that a man would not want. Allahu Akbar. To endure that and to bear that and to bear whatever pain you go through in childbirth and so on. These are means of gaining closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that a man can never have. So she is raised above us. In that, she is a mother, she has been given a role to play, she has so much, she has been, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has elevated the status of a female. And emotionally, she is a little bit softer. We cannot deny that. They call them the fairer sex, Allahu Akbar. Why? Softer in nature. The voice is different. You can pick up the voice. Imagine you had to marry a woman and she comes and say, hello my husband, how are you? How would you think for a moment, hey, you know what? You need to hear a sweet voice. Come on, man, I married a female here. I didn't marry a male. Astaghfirullah. So we know the voice is different. We cannot deny, we want the voice to be different, don't we? MashaAllah, look at them laughing, subhanAllah. We want the voice to be different. And I'm sure the women would love a masculine voice, you know. Imagine you marry a man and his voice is just like yours, you know. I don't want to imitate that one, inshallah. MashaAllah, tabarak. So we need to know this, that they are created differently, and we have that difference, and Allah has given them a role to play, and Allah has given them so much. When it comes to a man is given physical strength more than a man, more than a female. A man emotionally is much more stronger. A man does not go through the monthly difficulties, or should I say the monthly cycles that a woman goes through, and the changes and the childbirth and whatever else comes with it. Allahu Akbar. A man has a different role to play, and he is higher, given a higher status than a woman in that regard. This is why Allah says a man will go out and earn, a man will go out and he will look after his family, he will do this, he will do that. Today you have people who say we are equal, and we are equal in every way, saying that they are oppressing the woman. How? Because even when you say she's equal, what do you want from it? Have you thought of it? What do they want? They want you to go to work so that they can relax. They want you to go to work so you can bring in money, contribute 50-50. It's supposed to be 100 and 0. That's Islam. 100% the man, 0 the woman. If she brings something, it's her goodness. You are supposed to look after the women. So now the world has conned the women to say, no, you must go and earn more, because this rent is 3,000. He will bring 1.5. You must bring 1.5. So they made you a slave. On top of that, you must give birth. On top of that, you must go through your cycle. And on top of that, you must be able to be a softer person, softer nature. And on top of that, you must be attractive and so on. And they want to say, woman, a man wears the trousers, let the woman wear it as well. SubhanAllah, it's gone so bad that men dress better than women. If the women had to dress how the men are dressed, they would be covered more than what they are covering themselves today. They would be more religious, if you understand what I'm saying. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our women. So what we need to know is, when we hear these things, look deeper into it. I always say that today a woman has been reduced to basically an object of sex, an object of attraction for a male, and all the males must just fill their eyes, and just their eyes must be quenched, and that's it. So when you see the naked women of the street, you don't appreciate your own wife. You don't, because you've seen much better than her. You've already seen it. So Allah says, look, oh man, lower your gaze as well. It's no excuse. Even if they're doing that, lower your gaze. So you have a woman, and you know, you look down with respect, you speak to her. It doesn't mean, you know, there was a story of one of the mashayikh, one of the scholars. He mentions a story that there was a man in the United States. He was a religious preacher. He entered a lift, young man, and when he was in the lift, the lift stopped at a certain floor, and a female entered it. She was semi-nude. And he looked down and he did not look at her. And she was agitated, irritated. First time in her life, somebody's not looking. And she's stamping and she's doing, you know, trying to make a noise, making. And the two of them are alone in the lift. And he just looks down. He doesn't say a word. His lift stopped. She wanted to go higher. When he came out, she came out behind him. This is a true story. She came out behind him and she created a discussion. Hey, you know what? I'm very offended. Am I so bad, so dirty, so ugly that you couldn't even look? Now she's being honest. This is how the women have been trained, that you need to attract men at large. You need to attract men at large. So am I this that you couldn't even look? You couldn't even. And he says, look, my sister, you know what? I'm a Muslim. I respect you so much, really. And I have a wife, and I have this, and I have that. And I am, you know, and I don't want to insult myself and yourself by, you know, staring at you, and what am I going to gain by it? And he explained to her in a beautiful way, and she asked for his number. Now imagine if someone asked you for their numbers. Wow, mashallah. And respectfully the man agreed, and he felt that, you know, I will get the people in touch with her and explain. After some time, she accepted Islam. And she says, Islam has liberated me. from being a person who cannot leave the home without half an hour in front of the mirror, without spending on different types of designer clothing, without Islam has liberated me. I just put on a black cloak and I walk out. That's it. I just put on a cloak. And you know, it doesn't have to be black, but the dark colors are better, because it makes you less conspicuous. Imagine you have the abayas, which are pastel green and pastel orange. I don't think it would go down well. Subhanallah. Instead of, you know, not being so conspicuous, we would make ourselves conspicuous. And for this reason, look at this. A woman telling you, Islam has liberated me, my understanding. I am full of respect. People respect me. You know, you have a woman covered from the top to bottom. For example, I'm giving you an example. If she happens to break down with her vehicle on the street, a lot of Muslim men would stop with respect. My sister, please step aside, I help you. Wouldn't we? Yes, we would. There you are. Because this is a Muslim woman. I wouldn't like someone who's not a Muslim to stop and, you know, perhaps say something that is derogatory and do something. So that is the respect Islam gave her. And I don't know her shape. I don't know her size. I don't know the pimples on her face. And I know nothing about her. Nothing. But I helped her because she's covered. The minute you expose yourself and you have, you know, your clothing that is exposing your whole body, people judge you immediately. Because if you are a little bit overweight, all the men will pass, look at you and carry on. Because they say, ah, she's too fat to help change her tire. It's a fact. So I'm telling you a fact. And the minute you are drop dead gorgeous, they will put a nail to block your tire so that they can come and help. It's the opposite. It's the opposite. That's the youngsters of today. Look at what happens. So hasn't Islam given dignity? Hasn't Islam given respect? And people are saying Islam has crashed you, dropped the woman down. It's one of the biggest misconceptions about Islam is regarding the women. And those are the same women that are turning to Islam. Today, and I'm telling you statistics that you can find on the internet, Islam is the fastest growing religion in France, in Switzerland, in all these European countries and in America. Do you know which category of women? The ages between 30 and 40. And do you know which qualification? Those who are holding university degrees and beyond. Why? They are fed up of the life, partying every day. You know, going with your friends, Friday night, mashallah, partying, exactly with everyone. Saturday night, you know, we're having a party. Is that what life is all about? Partying the whole day, the whole night? On the weekend, we live the whole week in order to party? Is that what we have been reduced to? Until we die, we are partying? Or until we cannot dance anymore because of arthritis on our knees, Allah protect us? That's what life has been reduced to for them. So when they realize that, look, I am drinking, I am on drugs, I am on this, I am on that. Sorry, not me, I mean them. When they realize that I am doing this and doing that, what happens is they turn to Allah because they are searching for something. They are searching for contentment, searching for the bigger picture. And you have Muslims who are going away. So Allah says, وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ. Allah says, oh man, if you turn away, don't think we are in need of you. Allahu al-Ghani wa antum al-Fuqara. Allah is independent of you. If you go, we will replace you with others. They won't be like you. They will worship us willingly. Willingly. You know, we have in Egypt, for example, there are some mashayikh who try and spread the message and so on. And there were a lot of people who appear on television soaps, and a lot of people a lot of the women who were within the movies and the industry of television in Egypt. And At one go, 30 of them turned to hijab. One go. This was a few years ago. I don't know if you ever remember or you recall that. And they transformed their lives. One go. When I say one go, I mean look at how Allah guides. When He wants, He gives it. So there are people who are turning to deen. Why do we feel that we can still, you know, continue in our ways? And remember, to follow the deen is simple. It is simple. It requires a little bit of willpower, and it requires, you know, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the realization that this world is actually not all the glamorous things that are going around, you know, the glitter and everything around. That's not what it's all about. There is more to it than that. And so they come and they say, well, in Islam, you know, a woman has to cover from head to toe. Do you know that a woman must cover? We say she must cover with respect. No one has said you cover from head to toe. Do you know? We are saying a woman must cover properly, in a dignified manner. covering whatever she is meant to be covering. A lot of the ulama have permitted, if you are not, you know, made up and so on, to have the face and the hands showing. Some of the scholars say even that should be closed because it can be a point of fitna. But let us start with the lower before we get to the higher. Let us start with the lower. We say that even if your face is showing, your hands might be showing, remember you have got to what is called the minimum of the Sharia requirement. And we ask Allah to guide us all. The benefit of it is great. You are respected. And remember, the more people there are out there who are naked in terms of women, the less respect a wife has in the home. Because the man has everything out there to compare her with. And he doesn't know. And he sits and chats with all the women. Do you know the plan of shaitan? When a man talks to a woman who is not his wife, he is so sweet. That's the plan of shaitan. It happens to a lot of us. You talk to a woman, oh my sister, yeah, how are you? And she thinks, wow, what a lucky wife he's got, man. And at home he says, hey, you know, what's wrong here? You didn't iron my thobe, you know. Allahu Akbar, Allah safeguard us. Allah protect us. Allah protect us. Look at this. So, treat your Islam tells you, khayrukum khayrukum li ahlihi. What better religion can you have? What better teaching can you have? The best from amongst you are those who are best to your spouses, your family members. Come on. This is amazing. This is Allah. This is the teaching of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, when we cover, we have respect and dignity. There is a story that I mentioned when I was in the Maldives, and I've mentioned it also previously, and because it's true and it happened to me, let me repeat it. Once I was sitting on an aircraft next to a man, and he just looked at me and, you know, he was so irritated with the fact that I was a Muslim without giving me a chance. And he just said, you people, you oppress your women. You people, you oppress your women. I'm like, you know what? I don't even know you, man. And you're looking at me, we oppress our women. You know, for all I care, you might be cheating on your wife right now. Allahu Akbar. And then that's not oppression. You know, they believe to cheat professionally is not oppression. It's not. You can have 20 partners, or you can have 20 girlfriends or mistresses. That's not cheating because you've just got one wife. According to them, that's an insult. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. So I told him, he took his wallet out and he's checking something, and I said, you people oppress your money. You oppress your money. He said, what are you talking about? Oppress our money? Money? He says, how? I said, why do we oppress our money? He says, you cover them up completely, head to toe, against their will, so on, what? And he kept on going. And I told him whatever I had. I told him, you know what? You oppress your money. Because you cover it. You cover it up completely. You don't just show it. Put it in a wallet, don't you? So, the foolish man, he didn't know what to say. Because that's not oppression. That's not oppression at all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all. Grant us goodness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. People are spreading this misconception that in Islam, a woman's witness is half of that of a man. That's another misconception. They say when you bear witness in front of the qadi, if there is one man, equivalent to her will be two females. So they say that is oppression. Look, Allah has created a man and a woman, and Allah knows your nature as a woman. A woman's nature is soft. A psychologist will tell you that. A woman is soft by nature. Besides one or two iron ladies we might have had on earth, you know, you have softness within. If a mother, for example, say there is a person who is a murderer, and he murdered someone to cold blood, and there were two women who saw that, and a man. The man will come and say, listen, I saw it, and this is what happened. There was brutal, cold blood, and this man needs to be executed or jailed or life in prison or death sentence, whatever it is. He will come and say that, because he is a man. The woman, what will happen? She can be tampered with. How? Very easily tampered with. You just need an old lady looking similar to her mother, crying at the door of the court, weeping, or coming to your house and crying, look, you know, I tell you, I have no one, My son looks after me. He looks after 20 other children. He pays our money. He does this, does that, does this. You know, please, I tell you, by mistake, he committed this murder. You are going to ruin my life and the life of another 20 people. And you know, don't you have a heart? You know, how could you just go and bear witness against my son? And please, we have so many people. You are going to make us suffer and so on. For all I care, this sister, if she has a heart, she'll start crying herself. The face of the mother of a murderer. In a lot of cases, a woman would soften up to that. She will relate to it. So when the judge says, "What did you see?" Two pictures flash in her brain. One is that of the murder, and the other is that of the mother crying to her, saying, "Look, please." So she may or may not bear witness according to a certain manner. When there are two of them, one will say, "You know what we saw, didn't you? Don't you know? You remember, you recall." And this is why the two women, they can come in front of the Qadi together. They can even talk to one another. Unlike the men, they must come separately. It's amazing. Because فَتُذَكِّرَ إِحْدَاهُمَا الْأُخْرَى. The Quran says that if one is, you know, inclining towards something, the other one can remind her, "Hey, you know what we saw? This is what we saw." "Oh yes, 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 that's what we saw." Subhanallah. In no ways is that undermining the intelligence of the woman. It is in fact a compliment to say your heart is so soft and merciful that even a criminal can take advantage of that mercy in your heart. That's how we look at it. Why do we want to look at it? No, that's an insult to a woman. No, it's actually the opposite of it. Allah is acknowledging that your heart is full of mercy. Do not let a criminal take advantage of that. So that's why when there are two of you, there is a greater likelihood that you will be able to utter it. I had, and I'm telling you a true story, in March 2000 we had an armed robbery in my own home. Alhamdulillah, Allah has protected us. My mother was there, my wife was there, and so on, and six people walked in with guns. It's a true story. I'm telling you my own story. And what happened? Allah had given my mother a certain calm. And she says, "My brother, what do you want?" And he says, "Don't look. If you look, we will kill you. And the gun is here on the head." "Why will we kill you?" "Because if you look, you will see the identity. If you see it, you will recognize us tomorrow somewhere." So my mother was not. Anyway, to cut a long story short, alhamdulillah, they took whatever they could in 15 minutes. And they were gone. And some time later, the police station got hold of us and said, "We want your women to come." There were four women. Men were not there. "We want your women to come to the police station in order to identify these criminals." All four of them said, "We are not prepared to go." All four of them said, "We are not prepared to go." Why? "We just don't want to see. Never mind, Allah will deal with them." Now look at this. I am trying to tell you, here is the Islamic rule about two witnesses. There are four, they don't want to go. There are four. I'm telling you, wallahi, a true story. Because now what my mother said, I've sat with her, "Look, ma, you know, you need to go. Because these criminals might do it to someone else." She says, "I make dua to Allah." She says that. "If I go there, what if they get loose somehow, tomorrow they might come back." Look at this. Do you understand the thinking? They might get loose, they might win the case or whatever it is. They might serve the sentence and 10 years later, they will come and haunt us again. We won't sleep properly. Rather, just leave them, Allah will deal with them. As a result, the four of them were freed. And what happened? Allah accepted the dua of my mother. There was a police roadblock about 2 months after that, where these people, they had the loot with them from somewhere else and they were crossing it, and the police opened fire, killing all four of them. They were gone. And when the pictures were in the paper, my mother says, "That's one, that's another one." Allahu Akbar. Sorry, I'm pointing at the wall there, don't worry brothers. So this is it. That this is why Allah says you need to have witnesses of this nature. You need to double up the witness of. It's not an insult. It is an acknowledgement of the goodness of the heart of a female. She feels for others more than a man. There might be some men, but men generally won't do that. And there might be certain women who might not be like that, but generally the law is for the general. You know, it's a general law. You will find these qualities. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant our women goodness. There is another very big misconception. And that is, when a woman is inheriting, she inherits half of that of a male. That's a big misconception. Why does a woman get half and a man get double? Okay, let me tell you. That's not true. It is not a blanket rule. Look at the Quran and read Surah An-Nisa. Let me explain it to you quickly. Prior to Islam, a woman was not even considered as a human being. They used to bury their girls alive at the point of birth in the pagan Arab times. When Islam came about, it changed that. You're not allowed to bury your girls. You're not allowed, you and me are not allowed to be sad when you have a female child, because that is a sign of paganism. Sometimes it happens to some of us where, you know, I have a brother who told me once, my wife's given birth. I said, oh, mashallah, what did you have? He says, oh, you know, we had a girl. Why say that? We say, mashallah, she gave birth to a beautiful baby girl, mashallah. Why do you want to say, oh, girl? And if it was a boy, you say, ah, wow, she's given birth to a boy, you know. Up to today, people believe that. And up to today, people think that, you know, some cultures and some countries, not very far from yours, they would abort a child if the scan shows it's a female. That is the pagan Arab. So that's how they treat the women. And then we want to say that, no, they are fine. That's how they treat their women. Islam says, you dare do that. وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. Allah says in the Quran, that female child who was buried alive because she was female will be asked on that day, what was your crime and why did they bury you? She will be asked. And those who buried her will be held responsible. Allahu Akbar. Look at the status of a female. So now they say, when Islam came, Islam said, you should not bury your female children, number one. Number two is, you will not inherit a female. Because what they used to do, if Jack owes John some money, when Jack dies, Jack's daughter goes to John as a compensation for that amount. That's what used to happen at the time, at the pagan times. Because, and another thing is, when Jack dies, his wife automatically goes to John. No say. And perhaps his mother and daughters and everyone else also goes. And they are all as though they are slaves in John's home. Allahu Akbar. Islam says that is prohibited. Not only will we prohibit that, but Islam adds something higher. A woman shall be looked after by a man as an amana. As an amana. Because the hadith says, if a person has had three female children, and one narration says two female children, and he looks after them, and he gives them a good upbringing, and he gets them married off to good spouses, he will have Jannah in return. Clean. He will have Jannah in return. How will he have Jannah in return if the woman was not even supposed to be of value? One of the reasons is, when you have a female, you are bringing her up in order to go to be married off to another man. So you will give her away one day. And it's not easy to give your daughter away one day. May Allah make us responsible husbands. And may Allah make us responsible fathers. And may Allah make our sisters responsible mothers and wives. Now, a woman is taken care of. Does she need money? The answer in reality is no. She doesn't need it, because her food, her clothing, her accommodation, and her necessities are all taken care of by the man with the instruction of Islam. Islam instructs a man to look after the necessities of a woman. So her clothing, her food, her accommodation, her medical expenses, and so on, looked after by a male. So he has so much responsibility, because he might have 10 females under his authority. Some daughters, perhaps a mother, perhaps a wife, and so on. So he has so much responsibility. But Allah says, when a person dies, and he has left behind a son and a daughter. لِلذَّكَرِ مِثْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ. The daughter, although she does not need any money, Allah says, we will give her half of that which we will give the male. So the male will collect double on condition that they are related to the deceased in the same way. And if you look at it properly with your eyes, the female, say for example, 75,000 ringgit, the male will get 50,000, the female will get 25,000. Did you hear that? The female's 25,000, she can put it on the side. She can invest it. She can do what she wants with it. The man's 50,000, he has 10 women to look after, including that sister of his. So how much did he get for himself? Nothing. It all averages out to less than 5,000 each, because he's the 11th one. So a man has a responsibility. He's been given a bigger amount to fulfill the responsibility. A woman will always be looked after by the closest male relative. That's the Islamic ruling. Whoever is your closest male relative, it can be your husband, your adult child, it can be your father later, meaning at a certain stage, in the initial stages, and perhaps later on, if all these people around you have disappeared and so on, and perhaps even your brother, if he happens to be the closest male relative to you. And if he does not fulfill the responsibility, don't blame Islam. Blame him. So this is a very simple thing. Now, this is why Allah says, if she has no brothers, she will get 50% of the entire estate. Subhanallah. Half. وَإِن كَانَتْ وَاحِدَةً فَلَهَا النِّصْفُ. In Surah An-Nisa, right at the beginning, Allah says, if she is one, she will get half. And if there are two or more, they get 66.6%, which means two-thirds of the wealth, they will get it. Why? Because now, the closest male relative is going to be a bit more distant. So we'd rather give them a bigger amount, so that they may have to look after sometimes themselves, because of the male relative being perhaps a distant uncle who might not do the duty. So Allah protects the woman and says, take 66%. You show me one verse in the Quran that gives a man 66%. No verse. A woman gets the biggest share. You show me one verse in the Quran where a man gets two-thirds. He doesn't. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open the doors of our women. So let us not misunderstand. The people saying, no, in inheritance the law is barbaric. It's not barbaric. It works. It works to the degree that in Islam I cannot choose not to give my child just because I don't like his face. But the others allow that. In Islam Allah says, فَرِيضَةً مِّنَ اللَّهِ. It is compulsory, obligatory from Allah. You cannot choose certain people, your children. You might have had a misunderstanding with them. You cannot say, I am going to ban you from inheritance. He will look at you, show you the Quran. Dad, do you believe in this? You say, yes, thank you. Subhanallah. Allah says, آباؤكم وأبناؤكم لا تدرون أيهم أقرب لكم نفعا. The verses of inheritance, Allah says, your fathers and your children, you do not know which one of them are closer to you in benefit. And this is a very broad verse, it includes a lot in it. Benefiting either way, either side. You don't know who's going to die first, you don't know who's going to get from who, you cannot block someone, they might inherit from you and it might be vice versa. Only Allah knows that. So these are some very interesting points that we have spoken about regarding the misconceptions when it comes to the issue of women and inheritance. There is another misconception. People say Islam spread by the sword. I'm sure you've heard that. And wallahi, up to today, the television shows it, the media shows it, the people believe it. Everyone says Islam is a religion of blood. May Allah protect us and may He unite us and may He grant us a deeper understanding. May He solve for us the crises that we are facing across the globe. Amen. But Islam itself as a religion never ever spread with the sword. Today, we have from amongst us reverts. Which sword were you shown, my beloved revert? Which sword or gun were you shown? None. Sheikh Hussein, he does not have even one gun, mashallah. Not even one. So it is a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Islam spreads. Have we lost sound or is it okay? It's okay? Islam has spread through the Islamic teachings. You have sound? Islam has spread through the Islamic teachings. And it is not that a person says, you know what? It was spread by the sword. What sword? I want to tell you, the largest number of people who have entered the fold of Islam, and this is according to the internet, and the internet doesn't belong to us, remember that. The largest number of people to enter the fold of Islam in history, in any 10-year period, has been between 2000 and 2010. Which sword were they shown? Allahu Akbar. The largest number of people to enter the fold of Islam in the history of Islam. I'm talking of hundreds of thousands of people coming in. to the degree that in America they were saying, we do not have enough Qurans, enough Qurans, we do not have enough this and enough that, and people are reverting, and they are reverting in their thousands, and they are reverting daily. That was between 2000 and 2010. Allahu Akbar. Which sword were they shown? No sword. Look at how Islam came to these countries, to Malaysia, Indonesia, and the Jawa, and so on. How did Islam come? You know, no sword was brought here. So people say, what about the battles that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took part in? What about Badr? What about Uhud? What were they for? Let me tell you something. Think and think carefully. Use your brain and do not be conned by the media. And do not be conned by people creating misconceptions. What happened? Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Makki Qurashi. He was Makki. He belonged to Makkah. He was from Quraysh. What happened to him? They wanted to kill him there. They murdered so many of his companions who were Makki. They usurped the land. They kicked them out of Makkah and they drove them to Medina. They had every right to retaliate in whatever way possible and claim back their land. But Allah says, no, you don't have the permission to fight. Not yet. They were not given permission. To do what? Not to fight, to kill haphazardly. No, they were Jewish people who lived in Medina. They were not killed. Those who were the enemies were dealt with. But there were some people who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was dealing with even prior to his death sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He went to one Jewish man and said, look, this is my armor, I want you to hold it, I need something, and so on. There are so many examples. People were living in harmony and peace. They were Jews and the Christians. The Quran addresses them, Ya Ahl al-Kitab, in so many places. Why would the Quran address them if the rule was just go and, you know, sort them out? But these people who Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam fought were criminals. They had usurped the land. So it is part of justice to be allowed to go back to get your land. If someone takes your car and in the process you beat him up, and when you beat him up he ends up in ICU, you know, the intensive care unit, whose fault is it? Why did he, you know, purchase your vehicle? We had a Chinese brother in Zimbabwe. And he owned a restaurant. This is a true story. It came to my mind just now. He owned a restaurant and he was driving his car at night, coming back from the restaurant with some money, going home at a distance, some years ago. So he was stopped by some robbers. And the robbers, believe me, I'm telling you stories of robbers in Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe, inshallah, is the safest country by the will of Allah. By the will of Allah. Very safe country. But it just happens today we are talking of these things. So as he's going back home, the robbers stopped him. There were three men. They showed him guns. They told him, give us your money. So he said, look, don't touch me. This man was black belt karate and perhaps beyond. Don't touch me. You take what you want. Do not touch me. So they looked at him. They thought he was arrogant, you know. So anyway, they took the money. They jumped into the vehicle. They left him semi-naked. They took away some of his clothes and they left him lying in the bush. And as they were going, the three of them began to argue with each other. That man is arrogant. Let's go fix him up, man. Who does he think he... You heard what he was telling you. Don't touch me. Don't touch me. Let's go and fix him up. So they decided to return the car. They came back and they went out and they started fiddling with him. They started fiddling with him. He said, what brought you back? He said, no, we discussed just now. We decided we are going to sort you out. When this man said this, in 30 seconds, the three of them were on the ground. The man collected his money, jumped into his vehicle and carried on. In 30 seconds, they don't know what happened. Now, whose fault was it? Can you say that man is oppressive? Why did he fight these people? He should have waited. He should have, you know, he is barbaric. He's not barbaric. Or he is spreading his religion through karate. Is that true? He is spreading his religion by force. There is no religion involved. It's an issue of justice. You kick me out of my car, I want it back. I will beat you up in order to get my car back. There you are, as simple and plain as that. MashaAllah. Someone steals your house, you have the right to get it back. You go to the court and they will give it back to you. If there is no court system, what do? You have your own court. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. So, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he went back to Makkah, and when he had the battle of Badr, Allah told him, أُذِنَ لِلَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَ بِأَنَّهُمْ ظُلِمُوا. Allah has permitted those who are being killed, that you can retaliate now. That's what Allah said. That's what the Quran says. That is justice of the highest level. If you are being killed, a man takes a gun and you know how to get it back from him, or you have the means to protect yourself from being killed by him, you should defend yourself. And if you don't, you are a fool. Allahu Akbar. So now you say, no, just kill me because the world is going to think I was spreading Islam with a gun. So just kill me, come. How can you do that? That's the misconception. Common logic. So the Battle of Badr took place. They wanted to get the caravan of Abu Sufyan. Why? It was their money. It was their wealth. People say the Muslims were greedy. They just wanted to steal. No, you took our land. You took everything. You took our wealth. You kicked us out of our homes. We need this back. Come on. We are justified in this. It's nothing to do with spreading Islam at that time. In the process, all those who were caught were criminals because they deserved to be either life sentenced or they deserved to face the death penalty because they were murderers. So they had an option. What was the option? Listen very carefully, because this is a very big misunderstanding. The option was, look, you will be served the death penalty in a few moments, but there is one way out. We still want to have mercy on you. Didn't you kill our companions together? So you will be served the death penalty in a few moments. But one way out, if you say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, we want to tell you that in Islam we believe that that is one statement that can save you. You become our brother. Imagine how merciful they were, that they say, look, if you accept us and whatever we have come with is correct, you can save your life. We're not forcing you to do it, but you know that you are served with the death penalty. We are literally showing you a way out. You either have the right to face justice according to the international standard of justice, number one, or we can waive that for you. Allahu Akbar. Look at the mercy of Islam. And then people want to look at it as Islam is barbaric. Islam gave the enemies a way out. That's what Islam did. Someone say, well, why do you force them to say it? Well, we didn't force them to say it. They could have had their death penalty served on them. Imagine if all the prisons here or anywhere else where there are people with death penalty, you go to them and say, you know what, just say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu, and we release you. Today people would cry foul. But that time they did it, because that was the mercy of Islam. And this is why there is a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, يضحك الله إلى رجلين يقتل أحدهما الآخر كلاهما في الجنة. A beautiful hadith. One of the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the hadith, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala laughs at, or he is amazed. In one narration is يعجب, which means he is amazed at two people. One is killing the other, but both of them shall be in paradise. So some of the people didn't understand that. Later on they saw that a person like Khalid ibn al-Walid radiallahu anhu, he had killed quite a few of the Muslimin. They went as martyrs. He accepted Islam and he died as a Muslim. So bi-idhnillah, by the will of Allah and his mercy, he will also be in Jannah. May Allah grant him Jannah and us as well. So that is the beauty of Islam. No being spread by the sword. So someone might say, why were they given an option that you either pay jizya or you accept Islam? Because they were criminals. That's the reason. They were criminals. They either had to come this way or that way because they were criminals. But when Islam came to these places, did the people come here and say, you know what, we're going to kill all of you? If that was the case, Islam wouldn't be spread, because all of us, at some stage, we were not Muslim. Some stage in our great-grandfather's lines. Some stage. So how did Islam come to my great-great-great-great-grandfather, wherever it was? How did Islam come there? To be honest with you, we are so strong in Islam today that we are proud. We make dua for their blessings. We started this lecture by saying, may Allah bless all those who brought this goodness to us. Subhanallah. What an honor. So let's not look at it. Islam was spread by the sword. I told you, it's a very, very big misconception. And in this way, there are so many other misconceptions that we can speak about. But inshallah, I hope and I pray that I have discussed just a few of them. I think we are drawing, towards the end of the time. And perhaps if there are some questions which are relevant to the topic, if I'm able to give you some light on that, inshallah, I will try my best. And if not, you will have to excuse me, inshallah. So my beloved brothers and sisters, once again, I'd like to thank you really dearly for giving me this opportunity to speak to you, for coming here in great numbers. And really, I do acknowledge that from amongst you, there are people who are very busy. Allah will reward you. And from amongst you, there are people really who have made the time and who have cancelled other programs and who have their busy schedules, but they have made the time to come here. Brothers and sisters, I acknowledge that. And really, I appreciate it, but I ask Allah to reward you and to make us from those who have at least learnt one thing. If you go home having learnt one thing, inshallah, we have succeeded. May Allah grant me a lesson and then everyone else. Jazakumullah khair. Sallallahu ala nabina Muhammad.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakallahu khairan. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward our beloved Shaykh and to reward all of those who are attending and to accept from us and to make it from those words that will benefit all of us in this life and in the hereafter, bi'idhni ta'ala. There are so many questions. We will do our best in the time that remains to answer as many questions as possible. We did receive so many, alhamdulillah, in writing and by SMS. So, bi'idhni ta'ala, if your question is not answered, please send it into this email address. Jazakumullah khairan. So we have tried to choose those questions that are most relevant to the topic, inshallah. The first question, Shaykh, is how to explain to a person who believes in one God but doesn't believe in rules and procedures in religion, such as in Islam? If maybe you can repeat the question for the sisters to hear.
The question is how to explain to a person who believes in one God but does not accept the rules and regulations or does not follow them or accept them, if I'm not mistaken. When we believe in one God, believing in one God alone, it will lead us to the message of the messengers, because one is to have belief in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is tawheed. Tawheed meaning, yes, we believe in one Allah, but that oneness of Allah shows up in acts of worship. We need to ask, who are we going to ask? And how are we going to ask? We need to pray. Who are we going to pray to? The one God. But how are we going to pray? We are taught that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to be worshipped the way He wants to be worshipped, not the way we want to worship Him. Because man's brain is limited. As much as we think it is unlimited, it is actually limited. So Allah says, meaning the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَهُوَ رَدْ. Whoever does a deed, this is talking about acts of worship, whoever does a deed that we have not instructed, it will be rebounded to them. The sin of it will rebound to them. Allah doesn't want an act of worship that He has not instructed. So, you know, you have people who might tell you, oh, we want to worship the Almighty, the one and only, and they stand with two hands facing the sky, and they look up, and then they look down, and then they turn this way, and they turn that way. Where did they get that from? Their pockets. No one taught them. So how can they say, we are worshipping one God alone, when what they are worshipping Him with is something He did not teach? So we have to obey the instructions of the messengers. It is not so easy, because brother, you need to have iman. You need to have conviction. You need to believe in so many things. You believe in one God, so you believe He made you. So you believe you are going to be answerable to Him. So you are going to be a good person. So where are the rules and regulations of this man, of this God? Where are the rules and regulations? Someone somewhere needs to have given it to you. Allah sends a man to convey the message. And this is why, you know, another big misconception also, if I can quickly mention it, is the one of the Quran. They tell you this Quran is just a fabricated book. Believe me, from all the books that are available today, without any dispute, it is the most authentic. Without a dispute, it is the most authentic. So how can we say that, you know, this book is not valid? Look at the Christians, they have, I think now, it's approximately 38 different versions of the Bible. When I say now, I mean it's increasing. The versions of the Bible are increasing. So they have so many versions of the Bible, they have different translations. The Jewish people are also disputing a few translations and additions and subtractions. With Islam, what happens? You have a Quran. It is there, subhanallah. And it has not, Allah said from the beginning, this is the miracle, it will not be changed. Today, 1420 or 1430 odd years later, we can see it hasn't been changed. So that's a miracle. So we need to adopt that revelation together with the oneness of Allah. Wallahu a'lam.
Jazakallah khairan. The next one, Shaykh, is how do we defend our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam when not yet Muslims refer to him, without mentioning the word, in negative way for marrying Aisha radiallahu anha at a very young age?
Jazakumullah khair. That is also a very, very big misconception to start with, and I want to quickly, you know, clarify it firstly. You see, the cultures of the different places and different times, they sometimes are not understood by those who come later on or those who live in a different area. For example, you know, you have the cultures of the gypsies in Eastern Europe. Some of them marry very early, even the age of 9, 10, 11. I know of someone I read on the internet some time back last year, 11 years old, and she had given birth. Allahu Akbar. No one said, oh, this person was this and that. No. The world looked at it and said, these people develop very quickly. They are quite tall and matured at a young age. They lead a gypsy life. They live this way and that way. And some of the people made a noise and said, no, we will go to them and we will make sure they change. Whatever happened, happened. The point I'm making is, the culture of the time might not apply today. No one is forcing me or you to marry a child, or no one is forcing me or you to marry someone at the age of 9 or 11 or 13. No. Once a woman is ready and marriage age, no matter what the figure is, what the number is, she could be 80, inshallah, we can get married. If you really would like to marry an old woman, no problem. And if you want to marry a young woman, for as long as she is a woman and for as long as she is ready to marry and for as long as she has matured, alhamdulillah. So in our time and age, I would like to think 16, 18, 20, 22, 25, that's the rough age. Do you agree with me? Yes. At some places they don't marry until 30. Some places they don't marry until maybe perhaps later. And some people would marry a bit earlier. Up to today on the globe, there are places that they marry early, especially the rural areas within the Indo-Pak subcontinents, and perhaps maybe even not very far from where we are here. So let's not look at it in that way. When someone wants to refer to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with derogatory terms, you need to know two things. It must hurt us. It must hurt us. That is part of our deen and our belief. We must feel the pain to say this is very bad, number one. Number two is react in a manner that does not give a negative image of you and Islam and the messenger. He was desecrated physically. They harmed him. Ummu Jamil used to put some defecation on him. And he did not treat her in a negative way as a result. He was always a kind man. So when they physically harmed him, he was kind. When they are harming him now in our era, we will feel the hurt. But we should not react in a barbaric manner that tries to make the people confirm that, you see these people, we told you they are hooligans. They are starting with us purposely. Intentionally, they key us. We need to engage them. Look, it's not fair to say this. If I had to say something like this about someone who is dear to you, then you know, how would you feel? A few days ago, I tweeted mentioning the fact that the Muslims, a true Muslim, will never draw a cartoon about any prophet, not even about those whom we don't believe, you know, those who follow gods besides Allah. We will not draw cartoons of the Buddha and whatever else. We won't draw that because we are Muslims. Allah says, don't do that. Meaning, don't insult those who call out to gods besides Allah. There is a verse in the Quran. So we need to know when they do something, we must engage them in one way or another. We can give them a book, we can give them a CD, we can talk to them, or we can debate with them, or we can engage them in different forums, but inshallah in a dignified manner with the idea of guiding them. How many people were enemies of Islam and they flipped within seconds? Look at Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. He wanted to go and kill Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Clear story. It's mentioned in the books of Sirah. And the same day, a few hours later, he said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. We ask Allah to grant us goodness now.
Yes. Jazakallah khairan. Sheikh, a general question. Can misconceptions be used as a tool for da'wah, an entry point for those that want to know about Islam? Hence, misconceptions can be something good. Your thoughts?
Misconceptions can be used in the way the brother or sister has asked the question as a point of clarification, because different people believe different things. I believe a lot of people stay far from Islam because of misconceptions. Once you clarify the misconceptions and you tackle them one after the other, then you may have to go into the issue of the oneness of Allah, and you go into the belief system of the Muslim and so on, because they now come close. But a person who's already close, you can start off by mentioning the belief system and so on, because they're already close. So it depends on the individual you're speaking to, and it may be beneficial sometimes to clarify misconceptions for them to draw closer and to accept the whole Islamic message. Without clarifying those misconceptions, they might never even want to look at it. Wallahu a'lam.
Sheikh, a sister asks, why don't we have significant number of female scholars, Muslima scholars, to spread the right Islamic message?
Inshallah, I hope and I pray that our sisters can be dedicated enough to, inshallah, increase that number, and our brothers can be tolerant with them to help them and encourage them. I think one of the reasons, look, Islam does not put a barrier on that. In fact, Islam encourages the learning of knowledge for male and female, and in that, subhanallah, we should be actually competing with one another. But at the same time, a woman has her responsibilities. I know of lots of females who have started in the path, and then after some time they get married, and after some time they travel, and after some time they give birth. Before they know it, they give birth again, and before they know it, they give birth again. And so, subhanallah, they happen, not to be able to fulfill as much. But I really would encourage, today it's very easy to learn. Remember, the internet is a tool that is good, and it is also bad. You need to know, believe me, you need to know the source of your knowledge. If you don't know, you'd better find out. Because don't just learn from anywhere and everywhere. As much as it can teach you, it can also lead you astray. So we do have certain courses, I'm sure, here in Malaysia or elsewhere, which are online. And perhaps, you don't really have to go all the way to some place. You can be taught and so on. See if you can make use of these. Try and do that, and then you will be able to benefit even the sisters. So my dear sister, I would like to encourage you and all the other sisters to go out and learn, or to learn in one way or another the deen, with the idea of practicing and teaching, conveying it to others, especially to your own children and family members, because a woman really creates generations of men who are champions of the deen. Little do people know that sometimes it's because of the mother that this young boy has forwarded, inshallah, in the deen. Wallahu a'lam.
Jazakallah khairan. Sheikh, a sister asks, I attended a class where the brother mentioned that some of the ulama say that if a woman works, she must give her money to her husband to compensate him for her absence from her carrying out her duties for him. So please explain and clarify.
That is his view. That is his view. In Islam, a woman is entitled to her own wealth and ownership and so on. If the man has permitted her to work, or they have come to a compromise together, that's up to them. But for us to issue a blanket ruling to say that her wealth is mine, I think that is somebody's view which I would not really buy to. Wallahu a'lam.
Jazakallah khairan. General question, Sheikh. Many Malaysian Muslims believe that they follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but they really do not do so. Is this also true of Muslims in your hometown? What is your advice for such Muslims?
It happens a lot of times, sometimes to us, where we think something is ala sunnah, and a little time later it becomes clear that what you said or did is actually wrong. We need to be humble enough to change it. We need to be humble enough to change it, on condition that we know that what we did was wrong. So, if you look at the Quran, Allah says the first excuse that the people will give you when you call them towards what is right, they will say, "Inna wajadna aba'ana ala ummatin wa inna ala atharihim muqtadun." We found our forefathers doing this, and we have to follow them. That's the Quran says that this is the excuse people will use when you invite them to the right path. So we are not insulting our forefathers. If our forefathers are correct, we follow them. But if we now know that our forefathers had made a mistake, it doesn't mean you cling on to that mistake forever and ever. You need to become a forefather of a person who will come down your line who say, my forefather corrected my eighth father. Let's name it eighth father, mashallah. If four was a figure, it's not a figure, but I just made it one. I hope you understand that. So believe me, we do have that problem. And the advice I would give is to humble ourselves, to constantly search, to constantly ask. You know, it's like a piece of brass or copper where it develops rust. If you don't shine it regularly, you may have rust to the degree that your pipe will be destroyed or your ornament will be destroyed. So we need to shine it at all times, learn more, attend more, see, you know, try and look for what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. If he was here right now, how would he have dealt with X, Y, and Z? And see that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Wallahu a'lam.
Jazakallah khairan. Another question, Shaykh. How do you make an atheist interested in Islam?
That is a muhadara on its own. But I think by proving to him that God does exist, you know, just a quick simple one. You might have come across this on a lighter note where there was once a boy who was told by his professor that God doesn't exist. So the boy says, what do you mean? So the professor says, do you see him? He says, no, I don't see him. So he doesn't exist. So the boy says, well, you don't have a brain. He says, what do you mean? He says, because I don't see it. Allahu Akbar. Anyway, that's on a lighter note. But to be honest with you, there are ways and there are, you know, you will have to read up about how to tackle these people. And I think it is available even online where you can read how to tackle some of the people. And that's what they do to us. They read up their websites how to tackle us. We need to make sure we read up how to tackle them. The idea is whatever is the truth will become manifest at some stage. Remember, when we are inviting people to deen, do so in a beautiful way. We should never be aggressive. We should never be people who portray ourselves as though we are the most arrogant people. And that is something that turns people away from Islam. When we portray ourselves as arrogant, it turns people away from Islam. Let's humble ourselves. Let's bring ourselves down to the earth. And let us talk to people with respect. And we can converse. We can have a dialogue. We can question and answer. We can talk to them. Say yes, say no, and so on. And inshallah, in that way, we will be able to go forward. Wallahu a'lam.
Jazakallah khairan. Two related questions, Sheikh. The first one is the minimum responsibility of a Muslim to save only him and his immediate family from the fire? And the other question, is da'wah necessary for a minimal learned Muslim? Or should we leave it to the learned? Should we keep quiet until we are more learned?
Those are two very beautiful questions. The first one is connected to your family. Is the saving of from hellfire and so on only to your family members? Is it restricted to that circle? The answer is no. But what the verse means is you need to primarily be concerned about your family. Remember, sometimes you might not succeed with some of them. But your concern is there, you tried with them, the circle goes bigger and bigger, and then you try with the rest. Then anyone you come across, you try and spread the word of deen. And after that, you try to come across more people so that you can spread the deen to the maximum number. The second question is connected to, should we leave the calling towards Allah to the learned or someone who knows a little bit, can they call? The hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Balighu anni walau ayah." That is an answer to the question. Convey from me, even if it means a single verse. That means if you know one verse and you know it thoroughly and you know it properly and you don't know much more, at least that much you can relate. So whatever you do know, the little bit that you do know, convey it. And the day you learn more, you convey more. And those who know a lot more will convey it on a larger scale. And sometimes you may have to refer to those who have vast knowledge to assist you in whatever little you are trying to do. So every one of us, our responsibility is to convey the message in one way or another. It is our responsibility. And whatever we know, we convey. Convey to your children, convey to your family members, convey to your neighbors, convey to your business partners, convey to those you interact with, and convey to a larger and larger group, whatever you know, in whatever way you can. And this is why I normally tell those people who are very, very popular amongst the circles of non-Muslims that, do you know, for you to utter one word, that presents the correct image of Islam can hold more value than what a lot of other people who do not have your platform would be able to do. Because Allah has given you a platform, and Allah has given you such a platform that people look up to you for some reason. At least once in a while, use that platform to utter a good word, inshallah. And I hope and I pray that that is happening already. And it's just a word of encouragement for myself and for everyone else to say, we should use whatever platform Allah has given us to give the correct image of Islam. Wallahu a'lam.
Jazakallah khairan, Shaykh. The last question, is it wajib for us to believe in the unseen, the existence of Allah, the Almighty, the angels, including the shayateen and the jinn? What do you think about mystical things, the existence of ghosts and sihr, as the media in Malaysia are currently promoting it? What are the guidelines and how far we should believe in these things?
Firstly, the issue of belief in the unseen, it is a condition. It is a part of our iman that we believe in the unseen. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Part of the conditions of iman, you need to believe in the unseen. And we have mentioned for you the pillars of iman, the unseen. Then whatever is mentioned in authentic revelation, we believe in it. For example, sihr and magic, we know it exists, but we also know it is prohibited for us to engage in it. And we are taught the method of protecting ourselves from it because it exists. And that method is the correct method to save someone from it. So we should not be choosing ways that are not revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure those who might be affected somehow. And another thing, we should not just claim that everyone who is ill or sick is affected by something superstitious. Sometimes it's a health matter. Sometimes it is something else. So we need to know that there are limits to it, in that we have been taught the last two surahs of the Quran. We have Ayatul Kursi. We have various other, you know, du'as that we may read, or the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أعوذ بكلمات الله التامات من شر ما خلق. I seek, you know, the protection in all the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the evil that has been created or that He has created. These type of supplications will protect us. And we need to know, as much as all this does exist, we are not allowed to seek the assistance of, you know, the shayateen to achieve something, nor are we allowed to cure ourselves in a way that is not revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah grant us all goodness, and may He open our doors. Jazakumullahu khaira, wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammadin, wa salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
As-salamu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.